Hello, good afternoon. We know you guys are keen to get moving on the second essay, so we'll give out the topics for the second essay on Monday. And the deadline, the current day, I can't remember now what the current deadline is. The 10th? Okay, the 10th of November somehow seems a bit soon, so we're going to move that back about a week. Is that okay? Does anyone? That's okay. Is that okay? Oh, you're happy for it to move back a week? Okay, okay. So that's what we'll do, essay topics on Monday and the deadline back about a week. Okay, the next few sessions, we're going deep into the identity of the self. Today we'll just talk about what the identity of the self is and why the identity of the self seems to have some special connection with memory. And maybe on Monday we'll carry on with this thing from John Locke that we'll be looking at today. And then the next stop, either on Monday or Wednesday, will be Bernard Williams' article, The Self and the Future, depending on how things go today. Okay, so let's start it. I said there's thousands of words, thousands of articles, many books have been written on personal identity since Locke, and most of it is built around his example of the prince and the cobbler. That's really where it begins, because Locke really seemed to make a discovery there. The discovery is that you are not a human being. this is like the kind of thing your friends say to you late at night, but the idea is it's not that you are of some different biological species, but that you do not belong to any biological species at all. Biological species are concrete entities. How should I say, the human being consists of a body and a brain, I guess, something like that. But the self is a little bit more abstract than that. And Locke's point is you can make perfect sense of it being the same human being, the same person occupying a different body. So a different human being, a different human body, but the same person. Here's the story. Should the soul of a prince, carrying with it the consciousness of the prince's past life, enter and inform the body of a cobbler, that body being as soon deserted by the cobbler's own soul, everyone sees he would be the same person with the prince, the person in the cobbler's body. That would be the same person with the prince, accountable only for the prince's actions. But who would say it was the same man? It's not the same human being. There's a clue what the story is there. That the prince goes to bed as usual one night, and then the next morning there wakes up in the gutter the cobbler's body, looking for his servants, wondering where the tea is. And simultaneously, up in the palace, the body that was formerly inhabited by the prince is waking up, remembering a drunken night in a tavern the night before, and wondering who all these people are. We've all been through it, but what I mean is it's a familiar scenario from about a million movies or stories or whatever. Yeah? Is that perfectly clear what the story is? So biologically, it's the same person waking up in the gutter as was there the night before. Biologically, it's the same human being, the same thing, waking up in the gutter, the same animal waking up in the gutter, but it's inhabited by a different person. The point is that person is a more abstract kind of category. The self is a more abstract kind of category than the notion of a human being. I was asking someone for references in this, and they told me that the story, did anyone know the story of Yamada Kun and the Seven Witches? I'm told it's very, very popular. It's manga. I don't actually know what manga is. But anyway, as you can see, she is a real good girl, and he is a real bad boy, and they have the capacity to swap bodies. I don't really know the technical details any more than that, but it's very popular, apparently, it's current. So don't say this course is of no contemporary relevance. Okay. Should the soul of a prince, carrying with it the consciousness of the prince's past life, enter and inform the body of a cobbler, as soon deserted by his own soul? Well, when you put it like that, it looks like the key thing he's going for there is the idea of the soul. The point is the souls are swapping bodies, right? There was one soul associated with this body, another different soul associated with that body, and now the souls have swapped bodies. That is a very natural way to think about it. But Locke's point here is, well, one of the great things about Locke's point in this discussion is that if people can swap bodies, they could swap souls too. So if bodies are reusable, as it were, then souls are reusable too. If people can swap bodies, they can swap souls too. So this is not an argument for saying that you are a soul or that you are something non-physical. That's not the way it works at all. It doesn't depend on that. Locke says, I once met with one who was persuaded that his had been the soul of Socrates. I have that feeling, you know. you just get a feeling, you know. And he says, how reasonably I will not dispute, for this I know, that in the post he filled, which was no considerable one, presumably meaning that he's running the country or something like that, he passed for a very rational man, and the press has shown he wanted not parts nor learning. But the thing is, although he might have the soul of Socrates, although, I mean, maybe it's kind of an ecological principle that you can reuse, you know, it's, you know, just throw old souls away. You can keep them and they can be recycled, that's what I want, they can be recycled by different people. But that's not to say that although I might be using Socrates' soul, I might be recycling Socrates' soul, that wouldn't necessarily mean that I had any memories of Socrates' past life. Yeah? And if I don't have any memories of Socrates' past life, then even if I have the same soul, I'm not the same person as Socrates. The key thing would be whether I had any memories of Socrates' past life. Okay? So person is a little bit more abstract than any notion of a biological unit, any notion of the human being, or a concrete body and brain. Happy with that? Another way to get at the same idea is to think about brain transplants. This also is very popular. This picture is from a 1950s thing called Martian brain transplants. There is a Martian. and the idea is, suppose you were told that your liver is giving out. They say, the punishment you've given it all these years, you just can't take it. And then you're told that we've got a donor, we can get your new liver. That is good news, right? But suppose you're told in a few years, all that philosophy has been very, very bad for you. Your brain is wearing out. But that's okay, we have a donor. Is that good news? Put up your hand if that would be good news. Is that be bad news? If you don't know what the question is, okay, can you articulate? How do you know what the question is? Yeah. Well, it's your heart. That affects everything, right? It's connected to everything. The blood goes everywhere. Yeah. Making thoughts. No, that's true. It doesn't, I hope. I don't think, you know. Yeah. I suppose so, yes. Yeah. Now we have something bad news? Yes? Would you your own consciousness? Yeah, that's the question. I mean, I guess that's the danger, right? That you're not getting a transplant here. Your body is being invaded by someone else who is using it as a host. Right? That's why you wouldn't want it. Yeah? Isn't that right? But suppose you try and put your finger on just what the problem would be here. Is it that it would be kind of icky to have someone else's brain in your precious body? I mean, yeah? Yeah. Well, yeah, it depends exactly what the scenario is, doesn't it? That's what you're saying, it depends on what the scenario is. I mean, if you were around, let's suppose, then you would know if you're still around after this. Yeah. I've changed that body, yes. Right. Yeah. I guess that's the other way to put the idea, yeah, that suppose I'm told your body is all worn out, but rather than have you go through some tedious dieting and exercise regime, we have a new body here into which you can transplant your brain. Yeah. Wouldn't that be great? Well, I mean, I would think it was great. Yeah. Part of it, yes. Yes. That's great. Okay, I share that sense. If you're told that your visual system is packing up, but if you put in this little bit, patch in this bit from a donor, then you'll be able to see again. I go for it in a heartbeat, yeah. That's your point. But if it's memories, if it's essentially your sense of where you've been and what you've done, that would be different. Yeah, probably. Yes, that's right. If you lost the memories, you'd have lost a bit of your brain when you got the memories. Yeah, right, yeah. Yeah. It can happen, you know, I took that hunting trip all those years ago, but I just can't remember anything about it. It's gone. I guess it could happen, but, okay. But we're just asking the abstract question, would it matter if this happened? Not would you know about it. And this has come up before. Things that you don't know about can really matter. You see what I mean? I mean, yeah. If you weren't going to make it through the operation at all, yeah, you wouldn't know about it. You wouldn't be there, right? I mean, you wouldn't know. But it still matters whether you make it. No? Yes. Wouldn't yourself be dead if you don't remember? Yeah, I guess that is the thought. So that makes it sound like the identity of the self is not the identity of the body. The identity of the self is the identity of the brain. Right? What matters is the brain. Yep. You could think of, you can have most of your body amputated, but if you're left with the brain, that's just a kind of limiting case of amputation. Amputation doesn't mean you've been killed. You can amputate everything except the brain, and that would still be you. You see what I mean? So the brain is really who you are. The thing is, when you're arguing like that, what's going on here is, as a couple of people said, I think, what's important is that it's whose memories have survived intact. Yep. Yes, right, right, yeah. Very good. If you've got the brain alone, you don't even have a person. You just got a collection of cells. Yeah? If I've got a nice, cheerful disposition, and that's what everybody values about me, then having a brain there is just not going to be the same thing. Right? So what's important is that the brain be embedded in a body. But it wouldn't necessarily matter very much which body. I mean, it might be that in years to come, when you're born, they take a sample of your cells so they can clone a spare body. Yeah, that way, if anything happens to you, you can just pop the brain into the new body. Yeah? That would be handy. I mean, you see what I mean? But so you would never have a person unless you had a body there. But same as a person would be same as a brain, not same as a body. Is that catching what you're after?
Yeah.
Then your body would be the... That's right. It would be a different person if it was a different body. Right. That's interesting. Okay. That is truly interesting. Muscle memory matters more to some people than others, right? I mean, if you're a concert pianist or a weightlifter, then muscle memory might really matter to you. Yeah? You say, that's not me. You know, I spent my entire adult life developing these muscles. Different muscles, not the same person. Yeah? But if you're more cerebral, if you're a philosopher, for example, you might say, well, I don't really value the muscles so much. Yeah. But you're right, different people can put different weights there. Okay, you bring me on to my next point. Okay, that's really good. Okay, you're ahead of me. So the argument here is the brain is the thing that's carrying the memories. So that if you've got the memories, that's what someone was saying a moment ago, then if you've got A's memories, then you're A. and this I think is your kind of scenario, tell me if not. Suppose that when they're doing brain transplants, this might be in 20 years or so, suppose they're doing brain transplants. Doing a brain transplant is obviously going to be pretty precarious. So they might make a record of everything that's on your brain and store it in a hard disk. Yep. And so they can back up your brain just in case anything goes wrong during the surgery. Yep. So suppose that happened. Suppose your brain just got scrambled during surgery, but then they backed up your brain. I mean, they restored your brain from the backup. That was still you. That's all right. That's why you have the backup. That's right. Suppose it's just quite simple. Okay. Suppose your brain is just getting some surgery to help your visual system let you see better, right? And then your brain is actually everything in your brain gets accidentally deleted during the process. But then they restore your brain from the backup they had in the computer. That would still be you. That's okay. Is it? Put up your hand. That would be okay. That is very scary. Well, what's scary about that? It seems kind of icky. That's fine, that's great, yeah. Yeah. Yeah, but do you have something like that when you're asleep anyhow? Okay. Well, I agree with the unusual for that kind of blackout, yeah. But I don't really see what's scary about it, so long as you come back. Is it like what? Say more. Okay, very good. Right. Well, there you are. that's a real life example. Okay, yeah. Yes, right, right. Well, there you are. Well, you need to forget something, right? Wouldn't that be okay? No, just as when you're doing something to your computer, right? You make a backup of what's in the hard disk, just whatever happens to be there. Then if something goes wrong, you can restore the whole lot. Yep. That's right. Although the thing that you've forgotten won't be there in the backup. Yep. It must be a complete copy of everything that actually is in your brain right now. Yeah. Yes. That's very good. I said that the whole huge literature on personal identity comes from two puzzle cases. One is Locke's case. Yep. The other one is the case you just invented. Yeah, that's great. Okay. So what we do in that case is a separate topic that we're going to spend two or three lectures on. Right. So can we just postpone that? Yeah. But I agree. Once you get to this point, there's a live possibility that you could split. You could have printed. In fact, if people really like you, they might print off hundreds. Right. Why not every town could have their own? Yeah. Which one would be the original? Or would you be dead? Okay. There's no original. Yeah, that's the original wouldn't exist anymore. Yeah. Okay. That example needs a lot of discussion. And we are going to give it a lot of discussion. Okay, then now suppose that what's going on is that they've got a backup of your brain in the computer, but your brain is actually destroyed. The actual biological thing is destroyed. And they say, but we have a spare brain here. We have one that just isn't being used. We grew it, this is one we prepared earlier from culture. It's not, there's no one's brain, it's just a blank brain. it's funny what you're floating through the air from philosophy. Then if they put the blank brain in your head, then they restore that from the backup. Again, that would be fine, right? That would still be you. So it isn't the same body. I mean, it isn't the same brain at all here, but it's still you. So it's not the sameness of the self, the sameness of the body, or sameness of the brain. Here, you're with a different brain, but the resulting person has got memory experience of your past life, so it's you, rather than someone else. So sameness of person doesn't depend on sameness of body or sameness of brain. It only depends on consciousness of the past person. And that's really Locke's main point. Can you put up your hand if you're comfortable with that? Yeah. And if you don't really see what the argument is, or if you disagree strongly, or disagree. Okay, so people are pretty much comfortable with that. Very good. So the idea is, if you've got a later person here, X, and an earlier person here, Y, and X remembers seeing and doing what Y saw and did, then X is Y. That's what the identity of self is. That makes them the same person. Yeah. Locke says, since consciousness always accompanies thinking, and 'tis that which makes everyone to be what he calls self, and thereby distinguishes himself from all other thinking beings, in this alone consists personal identity, i.e. the same as a rational being. And insofar as this consciousness that you have of yourself, insofar as that can be extended backwards to any past action or thought, so far reaches the identity of that person. It is the same self now as it was then. So if you could reach back in time to some particular past person, then that is you. That's what makes it you. And 'tis by the same self with this present one that now reflects on it that the action was done. Let someone once find himself conscious of any of the actions of Nestor, he then finds himself the same person with Nestor. If you could reach back in time to classical Greece or whatever it was, then to the actions of Nestor, that makes you the same person as Nestor. It doesn't matter if the body, the brain, the soul are all different. If your consciousness reaches back in time to Nestor, then you are that same person. Had I the same consciousness that I saw the ark and Noah's flood, as that I saw an overflowing of the Thames last winter, or as that I write now, I could no more doubt that I, who write this now, that saw the Thames overflowed last winter, and that viewed the flood at the general deluge, was the same self. Place that self in what substance you please. So substance here is body, brain, soul, whatever, anything. It doesn't really matter. If you can reach back to it, then that's you. So far as this consciousness can be extended backwards to any past action or thought, so far reaches the identity of that person. It is the same self now that it was then. It being the same consciousness that makes a man be himself to himself, personal identity depends on that only, whether it be annexed to any one individual substance, any one concrete thing, or can be continued in a succession of several substances. Is that all plain as day? Yes. So you're not a human being.